executive orders issued by the governor of the state of California, the following meeting of the Board of Education of Delmar Union School District will be conducted in person, following all current health regulations in effect at the time of the meeting. Item 1.1, call to order the Board of Trustees organizational meeting of Fall '21. I would like to call to order the December 15th, 2021, governing Board of Trustees organizational meeting at 4:46 PM. By law of board policy, I'm notified that this meeting is being recorded. Item 1.2 is election of the 2022 president of the governing Board of Trustees. The governing board will select one of its members to serve as president of the board for the 2022 calendar year. Is there any nomination?
If she'll have it, I'll nominate whoever helped her continue as president.
Very nice of you, Doug. It's a vote of confidence. thank you. I'd be willing to do it for one more year. That would be kind of my max. So,
I did 5 years.
Trusting me for this last year of being for president. Okay, item 1.3 is election of the 2022 clerk of the governing board of trustees. Board will select one of its members to serve as clerk of the governing board of trustees for the 2022 calendar year. Is there a nomination for board clerk? Of the Governing Board of Trustees 2022 appointments. The Governing Board of Trustees will determine appointments for the 2022 calendar year and bring the board for approval. So first, so that you have the list, but the positions are Secretary to the Governing Board of Trustees, and Polly McClure has been doing that role, so the recommendation is to continue having our superintendent in that role. I'll just go through them and then we can talk about who wants to do what, yeah? Governing Board Representative of the North Coastal Consortium for Special Education. And right now, she was okay. And we have the Governing Board Representatives to the North City West School Facilities Council, where we have Doug and Holly's the alternate. And Doug's the chair. Governing Board Liaison to DMSEF, rotating responsibilities, and then the Governing Board Representative to the Local Action Network. Guys, want to just share a few, like, what you're doing, if you want to change a different role, mix it up.
good things, in fact, bringing back some money that was due us, so I mean, keep looking for that.
That's, yeah, that's great.
The North Coastal Consortium of Special Ed, we just met one time, I think, that's like once a year, find out special education, because for me, I just didn't really know, it was a lot of information. Happy to go do it again, it was educational for me, so. I'm also one of the students, I'm also very interested.
Would you be your alternate, just one of the other? Yeah, alternate coming up. Then, Scott?
Yeah, I'm waiting for the second.
Dan, of course, have a question about the opening of capital?
Doug, what do you want from my, legislative action?
Okay, so then, we have Holly as secretary of the governing board of trustees, we have whoever meeting on the North County, North Coast Consortium for Special Education, and Catherine volunteering to be an alternate for that. The North City West, we have Doug again, and Sharon Doug, and Holly as alternate. And then we have the DMSEF, do you all want to continue to rotate in that role? And then local legislative action network, we have Scott, Catherine. And if ever one of you guys, you know, isn't available, you know, to attend, to let Holly know, and she can let. It's great to have you guys participating in that, so this is definitely, so thank you. Okay, so that's the slate. Is there a motion to appoint these selected representatives for 2023 calendar year?
So moved. Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those against? 1.5, adoption of dates, times, and locations in 2022 regular board of trustees meetings. Anybody have a chance to look at the dates? Okay, any questions or changes? Is there a motion to accept, to adopt the proposed dates, times, and locations of 2022 regular board meeting?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? This is flashing. Okay, 1.6 is the adjournment of the organizational meeting 2021. Is there a motion to adjourn the organizational meeting?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? The meeting is adjourned at 4:54 PM. Can we wait 5 minutes?
We do.
So the meeting is adjourned, so we have not been called to order on the meeting, so we are on a 5 minute recess until our. We are at item 1.7, call to order. The Governing Board of Trustees regularly open session of the December 15, 2021 Governing Board of Trustees meeting is called to order at 5:01 PM. 1.8 is public input concerning items on the closed session agenda. We will now call members of public who have requested to address the Governing Board regarding items that are on the closed session agenda, and there are none. Okay, 1.9, adjournment into closed session. The Board will meet in closed session to consider the following matters. 2.1, the Conference of Legal Counsel. Pending litigation 549569B. 2.2, conference of the, oh, one matter, okay, well, we're going to read this a different way. One matter is defined on the agenda. So, 2.2, one matter is defined on the agenda. Oh, you want to read that? Okay. So, 2.2 is conference of legal counsel, existing litigation, governance code 549569D1. Okay, and one matter as identified on the agenda, 2.3, conference of labor negotiator, GC 549576. The board will now adjourn into closed session at 5:02 PM. All right, good evening. we're waiting. We're item 3.1, reconvene open session. We are reconvening open session at 5:59 p.m. By law and board policy, I'm as notified of this meeting being recorded. By law and board policy, any member of the public may address the board on an item on the agenda or any non-agenda item, but the public must present a written request to the board. Therefore, I ask you to kindly submit your speaker slips at this time to help us run an efficient meeting. Speaker slips for non-agenda items need to be turned in prior to item 4.2, hearing of the public regarding non-agenda items. You'll be recognized and called to the podium at that time. You'll have 3 minutes to address the governing board. For those individuals who wish to comment on a particular agenda item, your speaker slip will need to be turned in by item 5.6, hearing of the public regarding agenda items. You'll be recognized and called to the podium when your requested item comes up. You'll have 3 minutes to address the governing board. Item 3.2, recorded action taken in closed session. Governing board met in closed session and no action was taken. 3.3, Pledge of Allegiance. We now welcome on the floor for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
3.4 is approval of the agenda. Is there a motion to approve the agenda? Is there any discussion? Okay, all those who want to approve the agenda, please say aye.
Aye.
Okay, any against? All right, the agenda is approved. Item 4.1 is correspondence. Two is hearing of the public regarding non-agenda items. Do we have any slips? Okay, there are none. 5.1 is the board report from the Del Mar California Teachers Association with DMC today president Kevin Cunha. Welcome.
Good evening, President Halpern and members of the board, clerk and cabinet. I'll make this brief. I just want to kind of make a quick comment. We got started on our bargaining this week. On Tuesday, the DMCTA bargaining team met with the DMSC bargaining team. And I just want to say that we all, I think, walked away with a very positive feel for our first meeting this year. We were really collaborative in nature, and we were able to get a lot accomplished on day one. And I feel like we're just all very optimistic going forward in how this year's bargaining will go. We have a lot of work to do. We're going to do a whole contract, so we're going to be meeting plenty. And if things keep going the way they were, I think it'll be very successful. Without further ado, I'll get the real talent up here. we have Kelly Gaetro, fourth grade teacher at Del Mar Heights. She's going to be here to present some of the great things they are doing over at Del Mar Heights. So, here you go.
Thank you.
And thank you, Kelly.
Good evening. It's so good to see you. I'm very excited to have this opportunity. And we'll say that we went a little bit of a different way at the Heights. I'm sure you're all very aware of our split hearts that we're doing. And so we felt it was kind of a chance for us to not just show one grade level or group, but really just give you a little insight into all the grade levels. So we got together as a staff and we really took a look at our making thinking visible and how we're bringing that into our classrooms. And we wanted to really kind of showcase how we're bridging the district curriculum and bringing the thinking routines and really the thinking into that curriculum. Obviously, there are standards and the curriculum that we are married to, if you will. And so bringing this idea of making thinking visible and how you go about that with the curriculum, I think is probably one of the biggest challenges in really forward-thinking classroom. And so really taking a close look and a deep insight into the work we've done with thinking in the classroom. So I struggled a little bit because I had a lot of photos from the grade levels and a lot of information from the teachers, but I wasn't there doing the teaching, and so I thought to myself, well, in my classroom, when something like this is going on, we come together and we talk about it as a group. So I went to my class and I said, this is what I'm struggling with, and it just looks really flat, and we talk about 2D and 3D and how do you make it come alive. And my class looked at me and went, why don't you let us do it? And I went, you know what? You're right. Why don't I let you? So this is my class and their ideas about thinking and taking the information. Yes, kids. Taking their information from thinking and literally putting together all the pictures and their collaboration. And I did nothing but help with spelling and punctuation. It was really a great experience. It was really powerful for them because they were able to, as fourth graders go, oh my gosh, look at kindergarten doing this. Look at this. And it was really, really fantastic. So that was really fun. They really enjoyed that. So I'm going to put that back on.
Okay, we are at 5.4, board reports governing board members. We had a little bit of a busy month, so let's start down there at the end.
Great. Good evening, everyone. Yes, we did have a busy month. We all attended the annual California School Board Association Educational Conference. We met down in downtown San Diego and had the opportunity to gather with school board trustees and superintendents from all over the state and participate in workshops and hear some really great speakers. That was really awesome. And I also was able to attend the Film Upstanders at Delmar Hills. And it was a really just great experience, lots of amazing takeaways. And I also got to meet the two student counselors that work at Delmar Hills and Delmar Heights. Connect with legislators in our districts in this San Diego region and other school board trustees and superintendents. So that should be a good meeting on Friday. Thank you.
I'm just going to defer mine until January, thanks.
Okay.
Well, in addition to attending the California School Board Association conference, which I enjoy because you get to interact with people throughout the state and see what they're dealing with, and it helps us to address situations that we might have. I was also chaired the meeting for the North Southwest Facilities Financing Board, and I'm happy to report that we should be receiving a check around $200,000, I think, this year. But what I noticed when the breakdown was presented to us, I think San Dieguito is now done with whatever they're getting back, which means that the remaining amount of money is all going to go towards our district for these cost overruns for construction. And I think it's up in the millions, isn't that right? So we're happy about that and look forward to receiving those funds. And that is what I did this month.
Thank you. I, along with everyone at the CSBA conference, at first I went a little bit early for the delegate assembly, which is kind of meeting of school board members that get
I also attended the conference, and GYU did a great job on your panel. It takes a lot to get up there and tell your story, and it was great to hear. I know a lot of folks reached out to you afterwards to say how much they appreciated this, so thanks for that. And I missed the Upstanders session that I hoped to go to, so I'm hoping this will be another chance to see that, maybe in a virtual showing, or I know that folks are looking into what the different options are, because that sounds like a great session. So that's all for me. The next is a board report from the superintendent, 5.5.
Good evening. We are concerned about the negative impact that the ongoing restrictions and rules are having on our students' learning, on their socialization, and on our students' and staff's well-being. That concludes my report.
Thank you, Dr. Nussler. Item 5.6 is hearing of the public regarding agenda items. 5.7 is board approval minutes for the November 17th, 2021 meeting. Is there a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Is there a second? Is that you, Catherine?
Yeah.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? None? Okay, motion is passed. Consent agenda is item 6.1 through 6.27. Are there any questions on either of the consent agenda? Okay, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
So moved.
To approve the consent agenda as passed. 7.1 is a board report and Amplify Second. Sarah Raskin, coordinator of curriculum instruction.
Good evening, President Palmer, members of the board. It is a pleasure being with you this evening to share an update on our Amplify Science program. Perhaps you might recall in November during our board meeting, we heard a report from a teacher sharing what her first grade students had learned through our Amplify Science program. We had a chance to meet Spruce, the sea turtle, you might recall, and learn how the children supported the understanding the children had an aquarium to be able to understand how Spruce would survive in the ocean after being released from the aquarium. This came to light, this opportunity, through our Amplify Science program and through the expert facilitation of our teachers. And so tonight, what we'll have a chance to do is just share a little bit about our Amplify pilot adoption process, what that looked like very briefly, and where we are now with our program. During the 2018-2019 school year, we had an extensive curriculum adoption process. a year of piloting this Amplify Science program, and receiving extensive input from both our teachers and parents. The board approved the Amplify Science program as our adopted curriculum last December in 2020. And program implementation began this past summer and into now our 21-22 school year. This past spring, a team of classroom teachers and science specialists that piloted the Amplify program identified the resources and materials that teachers would need in order to kick off a successful implementation of the program. And the first area that they were really looking into was an opportunity to manage the hands-on learning materials. I know you recall one of the highlights of the Amplify Science program is a very robust hands-on learning, all the labs that accompany all the units of study as an example. But we had to think about opportunities to support our teachers in managing all those materials. And so what we're looking at is a picture of our new Science Resource Center. This is housed at Torrey Park. And it is an RP7 portable, and we have a science resource room manager who manages all of the curriculum that you see. And these are our many kits, K through 6, for units that support the hands-on learning of our teachers. And our manager will manage all those supplies as far as the ordering and inventory process, the distribution, and once units are taught, collecting back those unit kits materials and replenishing them for future use. Additionally, this team of teachers noted that our teachers really could benefit from having a synopsis, a one-page unit guide, to guide their thinking that was created for teachers by teachers. So since we had such an outstanding and rich pilot experience, we want to learn from that to be able to feed it forward into our classrooms. And so from that, we created the DMUSD Amplify Hub. This is an internal website that I'm going to show you. And it has a wealth of resources and materials that our teachers can use. And what you're looking at is one sample page, grade level page, but there's actually pages created for every grade level, K through 6. And what you see, as you would note on this kindergarten page, is there are tabs for all of the units that teachers teach within that grade level. So if we take a look at the Native Health Plants and Animals unit as a sample, the structure and format of this page is the structure and format for every unit for every grade level. And I mentioned that teachers really wanted a unit guide. So this past summer, and it's going to be small, I apologize, these do pop out bigger, but just to give you a quick overview, our classroom teachers and science specialists came together, and having piloted all of these units, they created these little snapshot guides to give teachers tips into looking at the unit through that teacher lens. So they pointed out the phenomenon the students would study, highlighted the big ideas and questions that will come out of all the chapters and lessons, and provided hyperlinks to resources and materials that teachers can use just right on the fly to support their students. We also embedded videos that were created by Amplify that are just 2-minute unit overviews of the unit phenomenon and storyline to support teachers' understanding. Additionally, on these videos, there is a materials kit description inventory, so before teachers ever receive those kits that are managed by our resource manager, they have a quick outline as to what to expect that they can receive. And additionally, we have inventory sheets that support the communication of all materials between our classrooms and our science resource manager. This year, we also convened an Amplify Science Advisory Committee. This is composed of kindergarten through sixth grade teachers across all grade levels and school sites, also STEAM health science specialists and principals. And we come together 4 times during the year to build collective understanding around next generation science standards and the Amplify Science program. We also talk about and spend a lot of our focus in discussing how we align units of study between the classrooms and our STEAM plus science program. So there's continuity of programming and there's consistency. And so our STEAM plus science specialists are really able to enhance units of study and support students with understanding phenomena on a deeper level that they're already studying in the classroom. And we provide feedback, and this team provides feedback on science needs, so we continue to grow in the program. Each Amplify Science unit engages students in solving a relevant real-world problem. Students love researching like scientists through hands-on labs, model building, and digital simulations. The teachers appreciate the spark curiosity and promote a culture of giving. When they achieve it, students not only assume the role of a scientist or engineer, they also learn about what a scientist or engineer does in real life and their impact on society. One teacher explained, "My class not only sees themselves as scientists, but understands what scientists do. We are no longer just doing activities for the teacher, but rather purposefully building our learning as scientists." As shown in the fourth grade picture that you see, students have opportunities both in their classrooms as well as the science labs to engage with industry experts and receive feedback on projects. It is our goal through science instruction to inspire students to be curious and gain the skills needed to apply their knowledge in ways that matter to them and positively contribute to their community. Thank you very much for listening. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I remember when we adopted this, one of my questions was, is there some kind of a system for people using this program to interact? And it's always a good idea to share ideas. So this seems like a really good step. And you might want to contact Amplify and show them by your hard work.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you. Yes, Amplify is where they've been really excited to see what we've done. And to your point, that opportunity to collaborate as colleagues, we've defined our professional learning, or I should say, proved our professional learning in a way that grade level teams are coming together and across sites and grade levels if they have common either themes, like we're in the physical science studies, and or we're studying the same unit, so that we're really building our collective knowledge together. So thank you.
Yeah, that's great.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And Sarah, you talked about this a little bit, but I was curious about how the STEAM instructors are kind of incorporated. Do they have like just a separate science lab, or are they part of like the group in the classroom, or how does that work?
Great question. It's different on every site, but essentially what's happened is during our professional learning, we bring our grade level classroom teachers together with our STEAM Plus science specialists. They're not only learning about the components of the Amplify program together, but in addition to that, they're talking about the management of the lessons instruction. So for example, the bulk of the majority of the actual teaching of the Amplify units occurs in the classroom. But the science specialists are well aware of the unit phenomenon driving the unit, and they can provide hands-on units that either extend off the Amplify. Amplify does have what they call extensions that extend the learning, but in addition to that, our science specialists are so gifted, they bring in outside materials and resources that support that unit phenomenon through hands-on learning in a deeper way for students. Thank you.
Thanks, yeah, I love the resource lab. That's great. That's just a really big service for teachers so they can focus on teaching and not dealing with materials. And also the website itself. It's all great. And just thank you for teaching science to our kids. They get excited about science when they're in elementary school, and that's what carries them the whole rest of the way. Because if you don't get excited in elementary school, you're not going to be excited in middle school.
Absolutely.
In my experience, yes. Based upon serving my sample set of two children. anyway, so thank you.
Thank you, President Howard. Thank you very much.
Okay,
thank you.
Great. Okay, item 8.1 is board recommendation to consider nominations for the California School Board Association Delegate Assembly.
We just need to ask for nominations. This is a position that GWA has been serving on as a representative of our district and so we can nominate today. And there's a deadline in the packet as to when the deadline is that the actual nominees would need to be in their paperwork too.
Yeah, nominations are accepted until January 7th.
Yes.
So do you need to be renominated?
Yes, I do. And okay. Nominated to the board. That was part of like a second discussion. It was like whether it's committed, but it's not
Okay.
Can you kind of elaborate on your experience as a delegate?
I've been appointed, so I attended, there's two meetings per year, so they usually help in Sacramento, as far as I know, but, the mid-years in Sacramento, this time a virtual. They provide a
And I'm assuming you'd like
to. I would like to continue doing it. I mean, you know, anybody that's, I would recommend it to the guys if you're interested.
Yeah, also, I know Catherine wrote this for last year, we didn't get the nomination sometime.
I mean, yeah, I would be interested again in applying for this.
Can you have one of the others?
Yeah, that's what I'm wondering, I don't wanna bump anyone up.
Yes. Yeah, that did pass.
Yeah, is it, I mean, if I don't see it, like, but.
So can we take over the $4?
That was kind of the discussion, it was like, because a lot of some other districts, they have like multiple people.
Are there?
There are, yeah.
Alright.
You can kind of see it on our.
I see, it's like.
I mean, it's okay, they're unified, but.
Some of them are, there's a certain level of, if you're above a certain ADA, that certain amount of students there, then you have automatic seats.
Yeah.
But we're not, so.
Right.
You just have to.
Well, I would nominate Catherine and Jiwa. Scott? You want to do it? You okay?
Okay, we need a vote.
I'm gonna do that.
Okay, so we have a motion, I'll need to, did Scott second that motion? Or, okay, Bill second the motion, okay, all those in favor of putting forward Jiwa and Catherine for the Delegate Assembly, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye, as opposed? Motion carries, alright, great, good luck, guys, we'll definitely vote for you.
Just a reminder, Catherine, to put in the vote form, they think they can make a vote for the form, and we have to submit it.
Four, seven?
Yeah.
Okay, we're going to work as far as superintendent update on district goals, progress on assessments.
Good evening, as you know, progress on goals is ongoing and happens at every board meeting, not, you heard one by Sarah Raskin just a few minutes ago, the priorities are in our district. I will highlight for purposes of kind of the big overview picture, a couple of our, three of our primary areas that we're focused on this year. The first one I'll highlight tonight is our work on diversity, equity, and inclusion. This work is an ongoing process and it's one that we're deeply engaged in right now. You can see here I pulled out the related priority actions. These are actually in our district design 2022 as identified in our 2021-2022 priority actions for this school year. So where are we with all of these right now? If we look at our progress, we can see here that we're really focused on what we're doing is looking at how we build a culture and how this will become actually part of our cultural framework. And what are we deeply immersed in? We actually have a district equity team right now. It has met 8 times and we will actually be meeting 7 sessions and we have 2 remaining sessions. This is part of our partnership with the San Diego County Office of Education. We actually also are forming our district equity advisory committee. This committee will begin meeting in January. It includes parent representatives from throughout the district and every school, as well as staff and principals. So we're excited about that advisory committee being able to learn, to get information, and to help inform what we do next as well. I already talked about our partnership with the County Office of Education. They not only work with us, but they're working with districts throughout the county so we can learn from one another as we work through this very thoughtful and intentional process to in our creation and development and continued work in our culture. All 8 of our schools are No Place for Hate schools, and that continues at all of our schools this year, and it's wonderful to see students actually leading all of that work and seeing it come alive and become part of how they respond to one another and how they treat one another and how they think with one another. We are sending a team to the Equity Conference in January, so we're excited about that. That will include principals and staff in our district, and we will share out with you after we attend that conference. The next and second part or priority that I will share with you tonight is the virtual world and its impact on students. We've talked about that with you already, the importance of human-to-human connection and the impact that digital devices, social media, et cetera, are having on our students. So what progress are we making? We have talked about the various organizations related to pediatrics and medicine that have referred to this as a national mental health crisis. That was actually in October that was categorized as such. And we see this as a call to action. So looking at what this means to our children, what they're going through right now, and obviously in the midst of, you know, coming off at this stage of a pandemic, as well as the world that they're living in with social media, and really being the first generation to grow up with this, it is our call to action to address it, to support it. And how are we doing that? It actually was the number one response generator topic from our parents as far as what would they be interested in participating in parent speaker series about, was this issue of helping children navigate the world that they're living in related to social media and the digital world. We did, as you mentioned earlier, Erica, we are presenting our standards multiple times at every school site. This is part of our call to action to have this be a conversation with our parents. That part of it is an adult conversation. We are looking to present it again, as well as I know the request made to possibly do something that might be virtual as well. So we're looking at all of that, and we'll follow up with you on that. Our counselors are becoming a big part of the work that we're doing with our children. As we know, our children are actually coming from different places. Some of our children have been, last year were not in school, and most of our children were in person, but some of them weren't, so they're coming off of that experience of not being in school. And so looking at, you know, the variety of different contexts and life experiences that our kids are coming to, we're very fortunate and thrilled that our counselors are part of the work with our children in our schools. And I did talk about this already. And when we think about our kids, the isolation, the depression, and the anxiety really is real. And when we think about why is this rising to such a priority for us and truly a call to action, is to address that so we can impact and affect our children's lives today. The third area I'll talk about is environments. This is one of our three levers. It is important. We know that the environments matter. They're part of how children learn and how they interact in the space impacts their learning and the meaning that they get out of the entire school experience. It's the context of when they walk into a school and what happens within that school that we look at all around. So when we look at this year, and actually we look at we've got a lot of priority actions in here. I'll pull up some of those learning spaces that we're focusing on this year. Kindergarten, first grade at Delmar Heights, second grade at all schools. You can see we've really focused in on where do we have these prototype classrooms and then expanding it throughout the district. And it's exciting to see it actually expanding everywhere in the district, both inside and focused on outdoor learning areas, which we'll share more about at a following meeting. So our progress here, you can see that this is part of our outdoor learning. This is art at Sycamore Ridge. Help me out. I think it's Sycamore Ridge. There's some similarity there. And you can see here that our indoor spaces are really looking at the variety of the furniture, the layout, the room, the movability that we can see here. And this actually is the library, what used to be the library at Sage Canyon, now the innovation space at Sage Canyon. So we've opened that all up, connected to what used to be the technology lab, to what used to be the library, into this one large innovation space that really is transforming how that space is being used. This is our science lab at Ocean Air School. So no longer with stagnant desks. You can see here it looks like it is a place where science actually happens in a very active way. And this is an example of one of our upper grade classrooms and one of our lower grade classrooms. So we are committed to, when we know the types of environments now after years of doing research and working with our teachers and our staff, we know what is conducive to meaningful learning and what works for individual kids. Not all kids need the same thing. And so having a variety of spaces and a variety of options for children to learn and participate in throughout the day is important. We've done a lot of research and learning on our own, and now we're committed to that district-wide, not only to where we have brand new school construction. So that's what's an exciting thing to see unfold. So that concludes the overall progress.
progress report on those three big areas with CME.
Thank you. Oh, can I ask one question? How can the committee be informed? How can a parent who's interested apply or find out more information for the
We'll be sharing. Yeah, we'll be sharing that. We want to make sure that we have a variety of perspective represented. So we'll be sharing that as we move along.
Okay, thank you.
Have a question. For the students that you were talking about a little bit about like the mental health issues, I was curious like if students are struggling or like parents notice students are struggling, how does that work? Like how what are the ways that people help them? How do we identify them?
With the counselors that I was in just part you want.
Just in general, like when students are struggling with like mental health issues and what are things in place to identify those students and how to help them?
I'll turn to Jenny to speak a little bit to that.
Hi. Yes, so we do have systems in place for through our student study teams for to follow up with our counselors or our psychologists depending on the needs of the student. And we also have we do have a self-referral process for our counselors, and we're based on the information that Holly shared, we're always starting with parents talking to pediatricians to make sure that students aren't, that we're not missing any bigger issues. So our school-based teams are always starting at a referral place of talking to parents about talking to their medical professionals as well for dealing with more significant issues related to depression and anxiety, but we do have a referral process for our school counselors and then a tiered system of support all the way up to our mental health therapist who is a licensed social worker.
Great, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, 9.2 is board approval technology equipment purchase through SPUR GPA membership for Stella Montague.
Thank you, President Halpern, members of the board, and Superintendent Clerk. There we go. Here presents our monthly facilities update, and a little bit quicker this month. There's not quite so much to report, but we'll give you a quick update on our three major projects that we're working on right now. We'll start with the Delmar Hills Academy modernization. As you know, we've conducted community planning sessions at the end of last school year and the beginning of this school year, and we're continuing to work on our exterior options and classroom layouts, and Lion Office and their engineers have done some thorough work in looking at the structure itself and what we can do, because it's really made structured out of these big cast in place concrete and then these holes that come up in between them hold together, and then it all comes to these points in the middle. So it really is not constructed the way that you see construction right now as much as it's very structurally sound, but how we modernize it is dependent on how some of those concrete pieces. So they've really been delving into it, and that's helping us to understand how we can do the classroom layout and things like windows and getting natural light in there. So we're making progress with that, but it is taking some time to delve into that and have to do the structural analysis. So at this point, again, we are continuing to work on exterior options, and looking at the entrance to the school and in the classroom layouts and windows and how those that exterior light can be brought in. As we look at Pacific Sky School, we continue to make good progress. Construction is ongoing, and we still have our anticipated start date on August 15th of 2022. We did have a little bit of rain, but our team has done a great job of working some Saturdays to get ahead of things, and we'll continue to do that to make up for days like we had yesterday, which definitely slowed construction. But if you look at the site, great progress being made. If we look up here on the top left, we are at the north end, actually starting to see them prep so that you can do some of the stucco on the exterior. The roofing, it looks like there's a roof on there. That roof still needs insulation and a membrane to get to the actual metal roof that's going on, but they're making great progress in bringing that out, and they're actually putting some of the insulation in today. Here on the top right, that's actually looking out from what our admin and office assistant will see. So that is the front office, and so you start to see what it will look like looking out to the parking lot and the entrance of the school. And then the bottom, just showing that we are actually starting to do some of the drywall and even some of the finish on the drywall in a couple of classrooms in our north end. So a lot of progress continues to be made, and great effort and great work by Erickson Hall, OBR, and Mike Gallis up there every day helping to keep moving forward. And then with the Delmont High School rebuild, as you know, the coastal development permit process, we had unanimous approval from the Planning Commission, and that approval was appealed by the Copio on behalf of the State of the Field. We are still working with the city, working diligently and in close contact to docket a council hearing date for the city council, and we will let the community know as soon as that is docketed, as we did for the Planning Commission. And upon receipt of that coastal development permit, we will update the construction timeline and commence moving forward with the next steps there. And with that, I would be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Thank you. You want to add 9.2 then?
Yes. So 9.2 is a technology equipment, and looking at 9.2, this is through a JPA, it's for JPA, which is a contract we've used for procurement. This is for the Pacific Sky School, and these are really the network infrastructure for the school. So we look at switches and routers and access points that will make up that network infrastructure and some of the installation on it. And so we are recommending approval of this award for AMS.net. This is the company who also did the exterior outdoor wireless access points when we moved into COVID. So we have had a good experience with them, both installing and configuring equipment. And we'd like to move forward with this now so we can get it on order and have it in time to open the school in August.
Question? Okay, is there a motion to approve this? Is there a second? Those in favor of approving the technology equipment purchase, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, those opposed? None? Okay, the motion is passed. And then 9.3, board approval, award of contract for requests for proposals 2021-2022 award technology equipment E-rate.
So this is this looks a little bit different. It's actually the same basic equipment that we're looking for Delmar Heights, except because of the timing of the school, we can also utilize E-Rate, which is a federal program, and we have the ability to use some funding for that. And so a decent portion of this will also be funded by E-Rate. E-Rate is federal network infrastructure. It really helps to fund network infrastructure in schools. And we get, with our demographic, we pay for 60%, the federal government pays for 40%, oftentimes you pay 100%, you get refunded the 40%. But a good portion would come under that. So we'll, the dollar figures you see are the full dollar figures, so it will actually cost the district less than this. I will share that we went through an RFP process, so request proposal process, where we received proposals from these four companies. We did rate them and look through the process, looking for the best value for the district. And while the company that we are recommending is not the lowest cost, they will bring the best value. And through that process, we're able to evaluate and go through and determine a company. And in this case, where you're not just procuring equipment that we then install, but we also have an installation and configuration, that is a part of that scoring. We want to make sure that when you're talking about the switches and routers and access points that are the network backbone for the school, that the full process, not just the equipment, is carried out to the highest standard. So we are recommending AMS.net. While they aren't the lowest cost, they will bring the best value to the district, and we're confident that the project will be completed successfully with them.
Question, Chris?
Yeah.
As far as maintenance, once it's installed, how does that work?
So our team does most of the maintenance. There is some warranty on Cisco equipment, so that's included as well. And then we set a budgeting refresh, typically about 6 to 8 years on the back end equipment like that is what you do. And so we end up with a refresh, and probably I have to look, but I think in about 2 years we'll start actually refreshing for our other schools. So we then typically do over the course of 3 or 4 years, we refresh and then a few years off, and we go through. So all of our sites kind of have a continual cycle.
Okay,
or questions, so is there a motion to approve?
I'll move to approve.
Okay.
I'll second.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, the motion to award the contract for request for proposals has passed.
Thank you very much.
10.1 is board review and approval of the 2021-22 first interim budget with Kathy Burks, Assistant Superintendent of Business Services.
Good evening, President Halpern and Governing Board of Trustees. This evening, I would like to present to you the 21-22 first interim budget and for your approval. So under this presentation, we'll be looking at the adopted budget versus first interim, a general fund summary, a multi-year projection, and looking ahead. As we take a look at our revenue, we can see that at adopted budget, we were at $67.9 million. We've had some carryover and budget adjustments, bringing our first interim revenue to $68.2 million. The variances that have occurred is in regards to adjusting our expanded learning opportunities grant, recognizing some special education programs, revenue, and also the donations and the increase from our foundation. Our expenditures, we at adopted budget had $67.9 million. With carryover and budget adjustments, our first interim is at $67 million. The variance that had occurred is basically adjusting our salary and benefits to actual based upon information we have as of October 31st. Some of the positions were offset from categorical funds and also adjusting staffing to meet program needs. After the budget, there was a reduction to the unemployment insurance rate from 1.23 to 0.5. We also recognize the carryover and donations we have for books and supplies. We adjusted to actual our operating expenditures and looking to planning ahead for universal meals, we're budgeting to purchase lunch trucks to deliver lunches to school sites. So our ending fund balance at first interim is $18.9 million. We are going to beginning to reserve for our social science curriculum adoption as we had done for our Amplify Science. And so we have our minimum reserve of 15% at about $10 million, and also the 3% reserve for economic uncertainty at about $2 million, so an unrestricted reserve percentage at 26.9%. And then looking at our general fund summary, it is just a different way in a pie chart where we can see that our LCFS sources is at 82.7%, which is mostly our property tax revenue. And our expenditures, total salary and benefits is at 84.5%. When we take a look at our multi-year projection, we use our school services dartboard. We are projecting our property taxes to increase about 3.25% each year. Our average daily attendance is increasing, and we always look at our step and column, which increases about 2%, and any adjustments to our pension costs. So when we look at the first projected year, we can see that there is a decrease to the revenue due to our categorical programs, one-time funding, and also, but then increasing back up on the second projected year. Our expenditures, you can see that we have a slight increase occurring in our first projected year, and that is with Pacific Cottage Ranch opening up, and then continued increase into our second projected year, which leaves us at a, you can see our ending fund balance is slowly increasing from 26.9% to 27.5% to 28.6%. Always keeping in reserve our social science curriculum and our reserve for economic uncertainties and our other reserves too. So when we look ahead, we will be projecting our enrollment. We will always be looking at our annual adjustments for STIRS and PERS, our social science curriculum, but also any implementation for the 2022 Budget Act, which also includes universal meals implementation for next year. And we will be looking at spaces for our district training center. Currently, we were able to have parking up next door, but now that there's construction, we've lost that parking, and we don't have sufficient parking here. So we'll be looking toward other areas so that we can continue that important work of our professional learning in our district. Happy to answer any questions.
Any questions? Yeah, I know I bring this up a lot. I'm looking at our reserves balance and it's steadily increasing. I think the final projection was almost 29%. And I know we've got programs that we're not funding, like universal transitional kindergarten. So I'm a little concerned of that figure. Could you explain what the, you know, max figure you want that reserve to be at?
So the board has expressed that at a minimum, our reserve balance is to be 15% plus the 3% economic uncertainties. And I do realize that we need to maybe explore that language a little more. And in addition, I haven't projected what the effect of universal meals will be to this district next year. The only projection I have made is in regards to purchasing trucks for delivery. So when we think about what our reserve balance should be, it is always nice to have a comfortable balance to be able to get us through those times of uncertainty. And right now we have a couple of things that we just are not quite sure about. And then plus we are right now in the midst of inflation. So we know some things are costing more. And so that's the direction of the board that I've had is to continue to maintain a reserve balance to get us through those type of events.
And Kathy, that's something we can continue to explore in our next budget workshop that is, I think, coming up in probably January or February, as far as our direction on expenditure?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, is there a motion to approve the first interim budget?
So moved.
Maybe Doug, is there a second?
Second.
Joanne? All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, those opposed? None? Okay, the motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you. We are at 12.1, a board review reminder of upcoming DSD events. You guys have that STEAM Plus event in your calendar. For 12.2, board review reminder of upcoming district and DMSEF and PTA events. 12.3 is preliminary items for the January 2022 regular board meeting. Are there any? Okay, 12.4 is adjournment of the meeting. Is there a motion to adjourn the meeting? Thank you. Is there a second? Okay. Catherine? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. Meeting passes. Meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.
At 7:15 p.m. Thank you.
Happy holidays.
Oh, yeah. Happy holidays. See you in the year. See you next year.